Hello, welcome to my channel. In this video, I will be taking a closer look at some of the changes in AMD's upcoming graphics architecture, RDNA 2. I will also cover its implementation in both next-gen consoles, the PS5 and the Series X, and then the wrap-up will include some thoughts about the upcoming fight between AMD and NVIDIA in this new era of graphics. In order to better understand RDNA 2, we should take a look at some of the key changes in RDNA 1 as the foundation graphics architecture that AMD will iterate upon for many years to come. The fundamental change in RDNA is the move to a SIM32 dual compute unit design that shares an instruction cache, a larger L0 cache, a local data share or LDS, and a new L1 cache that is shared across many CUs. The instruction cache in GCN was shared between 4 CUs. With RDNA, each CU has effectively double the instruction cache available. The change to a larger LDS between 2 CUs instead of a smaller LDS within a CU in GCN reduces traffic between the CUs, thereby easing pressure on the global L2 cache as well as reducing power usage. The LDS also has dedicated ALUs that handle some of the data manipulation operations, both speeding up data flow and freeing up the main ALUs from such tasks. The improved LDS is key in enabling the dual CUs to work together as a single larger workgroup, which can improve compute performance. The new L1 is an array-wide shared cache that reduces bandwidth pressure on the L2 as well as being a faster low latency cache for more common data. In GCN, a CU had 4 independent SIM16 vector ALUs and a single Scala ALU to handle more complex ops. Each of the SIM16 executes a wavefront of 64 threads over 4 cycles. Multiple wavefronts can concurrently execute over the 4 SIM16 pipelines, making GCN a very high throughput design as long as there are enough threads scheduled and enough registers per thread. With RDNA, the SIM16 is changed to a SIM32 pipeline, and two of them, along with two scalar ALUs, make up a compute unit. The ratio of scalar versus vector pipelines per CU has changed from 1 in 4 to 1 in 2, and as gaming graphics has become heavier on scalar operations, the effective IPC of an RDNA CU has increased compared to GCN. Another major change is that each SIM32 have their own wavefront scheduler, whereas on GCN, 4 SIM16 within a CU share in a single scheduler that alternates between 1 or 4 pipelines each cycle. Each RDNA SIM scheduler can request and decode instructions from the cache every cycle, and the cache transfer bandwidth is 4 times faster than on GCN. As such, each SIM32 can complete a wavefront with 32 threads in a single cycle, freeing up precious registers and ready for more work in the following cycle. It is more difficult to optimize game engines to ensure there's enough work to schedule as a wavefront 64 each cycle. As such, moving to a wave 32 makes it easier for game developers to keep ALU usage high. While not optimal, but it happens, during cycles where there are a low number of threads being dispatched, fewer SIM pipelines are idle in RDNA compared to GCN. The last major change in RDNA is the massive increase in registers available for each SIM pipeline, where GCN had 256, RDNA boosted to 1024. I've often mentioned how important registers are when it comes to how much work a CU or SM is capable of concurrently running, and though it seems like an obvious target for increasing, registers use a lot of power and are difficult to find power gate during partial usage. In my last video on RTX Ampere, I should have mentioned that doubling of FP32 seems huge, but actually in using them all is very difficult due to register availability. Back to RDNA, the large registers also enables another improvement, where some of the SIM pipelines are capable of accelerating dot product operations, and with 1024 registers per SIM, a thread can contain a 32-bit element of size 32 by 32. This is very useful for machine learning, but also in games for tensor-like functions, if AMD decides to implement it. Overall, it is easier to maintain high ALU utilization of an RDNA CU at each cycle, and it suffers less under situations that cause GCN to be underutilized. Importantly, RDNA also contains changes in the hardware scheduler to ensure better scaling with more shader engines and shader arrays, breaking through the GCN limitations. The layout of fixed pipelines such as primitive engines, rasterizers, TMUs, and render backends means that all the other components that are vital for graphics also scale with more shader arrays. All of these changes resulted in AMD leapfrogging multiple generational gains from NVIDIA. Think back to Maxwell versus GCN in 2014 and how far NVIDIA had leaped ahead. Per CU or SM, effective performance for NVIDIA was so far in front, and by the time of Turing versus GCN, You could say it was a bulldozer versus Intel Core situation. And yet, RDNA did deliver an effective IPC gain similar to Zen, or even better. For the first time in a very long time, a single AMD GPU compute unit was on par with an NVIDIA streaming multiprocessor in performance. In my opinion, this accomplishment is not any less than that of Zen, and perhaps even more due to the limited R&D funding the graphics division had to work with. As you may know, new graphics architectures take a long time to develop. RDNA or Navi would have started development in early 2015, at a time where AMD had to focus all they can to ensure Zen was a success and brought to market as soon as possible. During this time, Polaris was finalized, in testing stages and approaching mass production. The design of Vega would be well underway, and then something happened. A strange 2-year period where early Vega engineering samples were leaked, followed by many more. AMD staff and even Raja talked about new Vega features to break through the limits of GCN. Official documentation refers to next-generation geometry engines, primitive shaders, deferred DSBR, and a new workgroup distributor to scale with more shader engines. Some on the driver team even publicly claimed these features were coming soon, even as Vega 56 and 64 were already released to a poor reception. However, nothing came to save Vega. Raja left, David Wang was promoted, and then finally, Navi arrived with all of these planned Vega features. Certainly an interesting situation if you care to speculate, but I won't, so let's move on. Fast forward to the present, and all of us gamers and tech enthusiasts are about to witness a new era arriving. The excitement is palpable. NVIDIA just raised the bar massively with RTX Ampere, making it seem like it's impossible for AMD to keep up. Now, I am sure most of you have at least seen or done basic napkin maths on big Navi, 2x the 40 compute units of Navi 10 in the 5700 XT. Doing so arrives at a figure around the RTX 3080 in performance, but it's never linear scaling, not for big chips. If AMD can reach 80% scaling for the doubling of shader arrays, that would be a good result. However, at 80% scaling, a theoretical 80 CU RDNA 2 falls well short versus its competitor. To have a hope of competing against NVIDIA, RDNA 2 must bring major improvements within the architecture. There are several features such as variable rate shaders, mesh or primitive shaders, which brings feature parity versus NVIDIA, but there are also two novel changes that should help RDNA 2's performance. The first is the main command processor, the equivalent NVIDIA GigaThread engine, is now multi-core, meaning it can send multiple streams of work to the shader engines. Within a compute unit, the scheduler can decode and launch 7 instructions per cycle, up from 4 in Navi. This can improve ALU utilization, making each CU do more work, and also benefit other concurrent work such as ray tracing, which I will get into soon. The other new addition is a dedicated screen tiled color and depth unit within each shader array. This unit, in theory, allows some of the novel features that Microsoft covered in the Xbox Series X architecture presentation, such as the sampler feedback streaming and the residency map filtering. These techniques enable faster level of detail or lot tile generation, reduces VRAM pressure or boosts effective VRAM capacity, and massively boosts effective memory bandwidth. Talking about the consoles, a small segue, I noticed a lot of discussion about the PS5 and the Series X and which is better. Obviously, they share many similarities, while the two biggest differences are that the Series X has 50 CUs, while the PS5 has only 36 CUs. And the NVMe in the PS5 is about 2x faster than that in the Series X. The difference in CUs can be summarized as 12 teraflops versus 10 teraflops, with the advantage going to the Series X. However, the PS5 runs at a much higher clock speed target, 2.23 GHz compared to 1.82 GHz, or around 22% faster. A higher clock GPU with the same fixed function units, such as the ones present in the shader arrays, will process the geometry and rasterization faster. The Series X does not have more of these units, simply more compute units per shader array. As such, while it can be faster at FP32 and texturing or ray tracing, it will be slower for the traditional graphics portion of the frame. As Mark Cerny puts it, a rising tide lifts all boats. Overall, I think the gaming performance of both machines will be similar. While the Series X will be slightly faster for ray tracing, PlayStation 5 exclusive games can use the 2x faster NVMe for more scene complexity and devs have more game design freedom. Ray tracing is one of the key selling points for these next-gen consoles, as well as RDNA 2. It's the reason why these products are marketed as the new era of gaming graphics. While NVIDIA has a head start with ray tracing, this matters more for gamer mindshare than actual developer support or performance. As I noted in my previous video, these new features are a collaboration between Microsoft, Kronos, and the graphics vendors. Together, they decide on the next iteration of DX12 and Vulkan and which features to support and how these features are implemented, which determines how the hardware is designed. With ray tracing for graphics, there are three key steps. You can think of it simply as tracking a ray's path, determining if and where the ray collides with objects, and how the object reflects the ray further onwards. Both DirectX 12 and Vulkan APIs use the bounding volume hierarchy traversal approach to track the ray's path. This is done to reduce the number of potential triangle intersection calculations, as otherwise every ray has to be tested against every triangle, something that would cripple any hardware available. However, BVH traversal code is highly divergent and very inefficient on regular SIM pipelines, hence there is a need for fixed function units that specifically accelerates these instructions. NVIDIA's RTX architectures use separate RT cores to accelerate BVH traversal and a feedback loop with SM ALUs to carry out the subsequent steps. AMD have taken a different approach with RDNA 2. They redesigned the texture mapping units, or TMUs, by adding in new fixed function blocks that accelerate BVH traversal and triangle intersection, with a feedback loop to the ALUs to determine further BVH traversal steps. The redesigned TMUs are now called texture processors, and each of them can accelerate 4 ray ops per clock. If we look at the Series X, Microsoft claims a peak performance of 380 giga ray box and 95 giga ray triangles per second. This figure derives from each compute unit having 4 texture processors, of which there are 52 compute units clocked at 1.825 GHz. A simple multiplication arrives at the 380 giga ray box figure. However, a ray triangle intersection calculation is much more intensive than ray traversal. Here, we see a 1-to-4 ratio for the new unit. In a complex game, the performance limiting factor of the RT step will be the ray triangle intersection. As such, the focus for potential comparisons should be on this figure and not the ray box or BVH traversal. The major benefit to AMD's RT implementation is that the regular shader ALUs can run concurrently for other graphics workloads while the BVH traversal and intersection is offloaded to the texture processors. However, this hybrid design has a major negative in that it shares the same pipeline that has to process textures. As such, if the scheduling is not optimal, peak ray tracing performance can drop drastically. This places our priority on game developers to reorder the rendering pipeline to keep texturing and RT steps as much apart as possible, and also run graphic shaders, which are not cache bandwidth sensitive, in parallel to the RT to maximize performance. Fortunately, this balancing of textures versus ray tracing is not too difficult, but there is a weakness in this design that can definitely be exploited, and obviously Jensen is well aware of this. Imagine SkinWorks, a new NVIDIA graphics effect that improves character skin detail and realism by multi-texturing subdermal layers, or fully ray-traced light bounces within the many layers are simulated. Though I shouldn't be giving Jensen ideas, he doesn't pay me enough for that. Overall, there is definitely hope for AMD graphics to compete against NVIDIA. The engineering team is brilliant, and AMD has been on a hiring spree for software developers. Lisa Su is on the right track, reinvesting profits from Zen to lift the graphics division. A lot would depend on drivers, of course, but TSMC's 7nm Plus is a great node and it will ultimately be a determining factor for RDNA 2's success. Just be aware that in the next generation of graphics architectures, NVIDIA will have a compute and tensor core advantage. However, AMD will have an edge on ray tracing if it's implemented well, while no doubt also debuting their machine learning capabilities for novel game features and upscaling. Of course, I could be totally wrong, but given the information we have, the hardware architecture implications are sound. Thank you all for joining me again. It's a great time to be a gamer and tech enthusiast. If you enjoy my content, tips for beers over at Patreon is appreciated. Have a good one and cheers.